98.5 FM.
Now, recruiting tips, advice, and better ways to train. B3 Better presents The Amateur's Edge with Jerrian Sanders, Randy Wade, and A.D. Roberts.
Good morning, and welcome to The Amateur's Edge. This is going to be a great day. We got our fellas in the house today. Jerrian's here, and Randy is all pimped out doing his... His regular G-Swag thing. You know, we want to welcome everybody. Listen, today we are talking about women in sports. Women in sports because, you know, what we just celebrated? We celebrated the moms. So, you know, in order to be a mom, you got to be a woman. So let's do this. We're going to talk about the women in sports today. You excited, guys?
Oh, we're very excited,
let's
man.
Let's do this.
Very excited.
Happy Bloody Mother's Day.
And a continuation from Mother's Day.
We're
to celebrate, you know, the women who are doing some impactful things in sports. Mm-hmm. So we brought on Radica Wright today from USA Netball. She just became the newly appointed president of USA Netball, so that's a huge thing. We're also going to be having a call-in from Jamesetta Cleveland. She's the founder of Sports MomU, a phenomenal organization that's designed to help athletes as well as parents in the transition in sports and understanding the whole journey of sports and how all this works. So before we get into that, we actually have a call from a guest speaker, a celebrity speaker. Mr. Hill, you on the line? Tyreek.
Yo.
Hey, how you doing today, man?
Doing great, man. Woke up blessed. You know, God bless me to see another day. So I'm blessed, man.
That's huge. So for the listeners, this is actually Tyreek Hill, the Miami Dolphins. Tyreek is going to be doing a camp here at UNF. June the 10th. It's going to be a huge camp. I don't know if you guys have seen his camps on online, but I encourage you to watch it because Tyreek is very hands-on. This ain't going to be a camp where he just shows his face, walks around, waves hands, and kisses babies. Tyreek's very involved. So, Tyreek, can you tell us a little bit about the camp and what we can expect?
You know, just for parents to, you know, see some high energy, see some see their kids compete and actually learn about the game, because I feel like coaches all around the world just be taking people money, but don't be really, like, you know, teaching kids how to play the game, you know, teaching kids just the basics and the fundamentals about the game, you know. Like, these trainers, they see stuff on Instagram and they try to mimic it, you know, with, and what the Speed Academy does and what I've put into the Speed Academy is, you know, basic fundamental training where basically, you don't need no weights, you don't need no bands, you don't need nothing. You just need to just show up, you know, be yourself, and just have fun and give, you know, full effort, and you're going to get everything that you want out of it, man. So, a guy like me, dog, I'm not the biggest. You know, I obviously, I'm faster than everybody, but, you know, the stigma about being in the league. Like, you got to be a certain height to beat to play this position. You got to be able to do these certain things, man. But, you know, like, you got to write your own agenda, man. So me being able to, you know, grind the way I have my whole career and show people that, hey, you know, I can change the game. I can do whatever I want to. You know, I write my own story. So
for sure, Tyreek.
Basically what the Speed Academy is.
Yeah, that's awesome. Tyreek, so I do have a question for you. I mentor a lot of kids out there. And when you really look at it in high school football, it's more shorter receivers than it is taller receivers. But these D1 schools always come up to these taller receivers, and they'll get them before they get a shorter receiver, even though that – shorter receiver had got more reception, got more yard, even though he a dog. So what would you tell, you know, those shorter receivers out there in high school?
Man, look, don't worry about none of that, dog. All it takes is one opportunity. You feel me? Like, so don't feel bad, you know, just because you got overlooked or just because a coach didn't choose you to come to their school. You know, maybe you just didn't fit their system at the time or whatever, but I just look at it as all you need is just one opportunity. You know, it's the same way for me in college. Same way for me in the league. You know, I got my opportunity in college, you know, because I played running back. Then once I started playing receiver, I took a lot of guys' spot. Same way in the league, though. You know, I came in as a special team guy, you know, and I told myself, all I need is one shot to get in, and I never look back, you know. And, man, that's all it takes, man. When you get in there, them coaches going to really see that, hey, short guys really change the game, the way that we impact the game, the way that we can just break the game wide open, man. You feel me? Like, because if you really look at it, you know, I feel like short guys can do it all. We can catch, we can break the game open, we can separate, we can, like, we got a full menu of things that we can do. You feel me? Not trying to discredit a tall receiver, but, you know, I feel like we do it just as good.
Okay, I got one more quick one. So, like, these parents these years, right, these days, right, they got their kids playing high school, 8-on-8, 7-on-7. You know what I'm saying? They playing football year-round. But, like, back in the day, we played other sports. What do you feel about that?
Oh, yeah, man. Like, I think it's huge. You know, and I'm the same way with my kids, too, though. Like, I don't let my kids play one sport. You know, I tell my kids to go play every sport that they can. You know, that's where that my grandparents, you know, manufactured me. You know, so I can be able to learn different movements in different sports. So whenever it comes to time, you know, like, I don't know. Like, I feel like, to me, like, in order for you to call an athlete, that athlete has to do something in another sport, you know, comfortable. You know what I'm saying? Like, a lot of people be like, oh, LeBron is, like, the best athlete in the world. Okay, can LeBron switch over to football and be doing the same thing, dominant, like, on a dominant level?
Bo Jackson type-ish.
Bo Jackson. You know, you feel me? Like, those are, like, the true athletes to me, though. So, I mean, so for the parents to be signing their kids up for football year-round, man, I really don't advise that, man, because, like, once you get to, like, a certain level, that's all you're going to do. Like, once you get to college, once you get to the pros, all you're going to do is eat, sleep, and drink football. Feel me? So, I advise y'all to let y'all kids play every sport that they can. Let them enjoy their high school, their middle school, their elementary days, man, and every sport with their friends, because once they get to that next level, it's going to be nothing but football.
Especially,
they're probably going to be gassed out by
then. Yeah, especially running backs, man. Running backs take a toll, man. One of my homeboys, his son got hurt in high school, and I was like, that's a blessing and a curse. That's a year that he don't have to put on his body. But they don't understand that. They just want to play, get the touchdowns, be the best at this. But the kid was already solidified as a D1 player, so him resting was kind of good.
Tyree, what made you switch from running back to a receiver?
I mean, I really played receiver my whole life, too, though. Like, I played receiver, too, though. Like, when I was in high school, I was just, like, an athlete. You know, I was just one of them guys that can do everything. Like, when I was in high school, we had a quarterback that commuted to Louisville. You feel me? He was real good. So, and then we had a running back who was real good, too, though. So, I would just play running back whenever we just needed a big play. But I also played receiver, too, though. But then once I got to college, I kind of did the same thing. And then when I got to the league, everybody just was like, oh, he a running back. And I'm like, I ain't no running back, bro. Like, I just played that because, you know, it was easier for me to get the ball. But then my dad was like, hey, you need to play receiver, bro, because if you think about it, in the grand scheme of it, like, the way you game break the game and you can catch the ball, like, it's more space on the outside than inside with those big monsters in them. You feel me? So then I'm like, okay, I thought about it. I came in my next year, year two with the Chiefs, started playing receiver. And then the rest is history. I just started, every offseason, I would drive, a lot of people don't know this, but every offseason, I would drive, 3 hours every day to Lincoln, Nebraska to go train with Keith Dub. And, like he can attest to this. He's a Baltimore Ravens receiver coach right now. But he was at Lincoln, Nebraska coaching at the time, and I would drive every day 3 hours just to go train with him while I was in the league, too, though.
That's huge. That's huge.
For sure.
I think there's a bigger lesson in this, too, man, that I'm glad you pointed to. Like, you played the position that was needed for the team, even though, you know, it was outside of your scope of things. So, a lot of times, kids and parents, they try to force themselves into a certain position or what have you. So, I think there's a bigger lesson in that, too, for the kids. But you got one more question, Randy?
Yeah, y'all ain't got a question. Hey, Tyreek, man, my son played for the Patriots, man. He working his way up, man. But if you ever line up against him, I want you to say, hey, my dad said you wasn't SH. All right? I want you to say now. His name's Sean Wade. He played for the Patriots, bro.
I got you. All right,
thanks for coming on, man.
All right, man. Thanks, gentlemen.
All right, we're going to pay some bills real quick. This segment was brought to you by Bank of England Mortgage Jacksonville, helping home buyers and homeowners accomplish their financing goals. Head on over to www.boejax.com to get to know their dedicated team. You're listening to The Amateur's Edge on 1010XL 92.5 FM.
Follow off-season activities on 1010XL.
Up, quick feet.
Brought to you by Duck Duck Rooter Plumbing and Septic Services and Safe Harbor Seafood Restaurant and Market.
Be smart, let's get the work done.
Roll through the off-season with Tire Outlet.
Does your home or building need painting? For over 20 years, Performance Painting has had the privilege of preserving many of Jacksonville's most prominent buildings. That said, we feel like we're just getting started. I'm Jason Parker, and our team thrives on preparing, protecting, and preserving the homes, businesses, and public buildings that make up our local landscape. Contact us today to put our years of experience to work for you. Performance Painting, prepare, protect, preserve.
Performance Painting!
Come to Bowden Eye for all your eye care needs. Hicken here. Did you know that diabetes is a leading cause of blindness and affects up to 34 million Americans? Please don't take diabetes lightly. If you have diabetes, see your favorite Bowden Eye doc and save your vision. Bowden Eye is dedicated to the protection and preservation of the treasured gift of sight. Bowden Eye and Associates, visit today for your personal consultation. Keeping the First Coast focused. New location now open off County Road 210 in St. Johns County.
This is Denny Thompson. Join me for the Gator Bites podcast presented by Southeast Orthopedic Specialists with new episodes every Wednesday. Subscribe and listen by searching for 1010XL Florida Gators podcast on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, or TuneIn.
Rick Springfield, live. Top 40 hits. Celebrating 40 years of working class dog. Friday, May 26th, the Thrasher Horn Center. Get tickets at thcenter.org. Rick Springfield, live in concert.
We understand today's real estate challenges. With low inventory and high demand, you need a mortgage partner who can help navigate your financial needs. Bank of England Mortgage takes pride in helping clients make informed decisions. From application to closing, every step of the loan process is made in their local branch. For more information, go to boejax.com or call 992-1000. Bank of England Mortgage is a division of Bank of England. NMLS 418481. Equal housing lender. Member FDIC.
The IRS has just received $80 billion in funding to hire additional agents for aggressive collections enforcement. If you owe the IRS, now is the time to take action before the IRS comes after you or your business. There's no time to waste. Call J. David Tax Law, a firm right here in Jacksonville, for a no-cost consultation at 904-507-4777. That's 904-507-4777. Or visit jdavidtaxlaw.com. Peace of mind is only a click or phone call away.
The only thing better than a day at Jack's Beach is driving there in a new ride. And now is the time, because it's the Summer Starts Here sales event going on now at Arlington Toyota Pre-Owned. It's over 350 premium pre-owned on the lot. All makes, all models, certified pre-owned, you name it, Arlington has it. You even get 30 days to love your purchase or exchange it for one that you do. But this sale won't last long, so don't wait. Shop in person, 10939 Atlantic Boulevard, and online at arlingtontoyota.com today.
E.T. here, and y'all know how much I like my brown water, but I ain't gonna lie, it gives me headaches sometimes. So my alternative is Brackish Vodka. This gluten-free alternative to Tito's is 100% local, and all monies stays right here in Duval. Not only does Brackish Vodka make you feel good, but when you support Brackish Vodka, you're also helping local charities. Try it side-by-side with your favorite vodka, and you will taste and smell how natural Brackish Vodka really is. And when you do, remember who sent you. Come on, somebody.
Are you looking for increased privacy and protection for your family and pets? Look no further than Superior Fence and Rail. Superior Fence and Rail is Jacksonville's top-rated fence company, delivering the highest quality fence products. They'll treat your property as if it's their own. So get off the fence and get your privacy back. Call Superior Fence and Rail today for your on-site estimate.
When you're on the fence, about a fence, SuperiorFenceAndRail.com.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, the official personal injury law firm of the Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. This is the Amateur's Edge. Brought to you by B3 Better on 1010XL.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen. You are listening to The Amateur's Edge. And today's topic is a great one, because we're honoring women, you know, just continuing to play on all of the great things that we had going on this week with Mother's Day. And, you know, women are increasingly ascending in prominent roles in sports. And women are, you know, the woman that we're about to bring on in this segment, she has just recently been appointed to the seat of president of U.S. Netball. Radica Wright, Welcome, Radica. Glad to have you here.
All right. Thank you guys for having me. I'm truly excited to be here.
Good deal. And so congratulations on that newly appointed role. This is quite the undertaking. How did this come about?
Oh, man. Well, first of all, I want to say thank you for having us here. But this came about, it's been a long time in the making. Mm-hmm. And this year at the AGM, which is the annual general election for the USA, I was endorsed by two of the member associations are different states. So endorsed by Florida, because I'm also the president for Florida Netball and Soccer Association. And I was endorsed by Georgia, in the state of Georgia. So I conducted a study for like 10 years for netball to see if it was a feasible sport here in the United States of America, considering that it was created here. And as a result, yeah.
I had never heard of netball up until like maybe a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, I hadn't heard about it until her.
Yeah, so it's been a while in the making, and I'm truly excited, you know, to take it to the next level.
Okay. So netball is a very popular sport in Commonwealth countries, and it reminds us a little bit about of basketball. But can you tell us, like, the differences of it and, like, what's the rules that make it basketball and netball different?
I sure can. Well, it's funny enough that you said that, you know, kind of remind you of basketball, because the reality it is, was birthed from basketball. James Naismith, who created basketball back in the 1800s in the Massachusetts in YMCA, was the same person that created netball. And netball was created as a woman's sport, a passing game, because women back in the days, you know, we wore long skirts, and we didn't have the capacity to dribble in that setting. So that's the result where they created that sport. But while, you know, you talk about the Commonwealth, and pretty much netball is everywhere else in the world, with the exception of it being popular here in the U.S., it's played in over 100 countries by more than 20, 30 million plus people.
Wow.
The rules are similar. In the sense that, of course, it's a passing game. But what makes this unique is that we do shoot in a 10-foot pole with no backboard. You have 3 seconds to release the ball, so it's a passing game. You can't dribble the ball. You can make bounce passes. We play at 100 by 50 court. There are only 2 people on each team that can shoot the ball, which makes everybody's role on the team an intricate part of the success of the team. So there's no one superstar. So that's the greatest thing about it. The ball is similar to a basketball. It's just a little bit smaller with the same grip feel. We wear identifier, which are bibs. So you'll see them with these little markings with, you know, like soccer, they'll have numbers, and basketball, they'll have numbers. We have letters, and the letters tells you your areas of responsibility.
Gotcha.
To me, man, it looks it's like something you should do before you play basketball, meaning because it's going to teach you how to move without the ball. So many kids want to hold the ball and dribble. Mm-hmm. Something you should do without, you know, before you learn how to play basketball.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
I'm looking at it right now on YouTube. It's pretty neat.
Yeah, it is. I actually watched a couple of games and watched them at a high level when you look at, like, the agility and body control and all that good stuff. Mm-hmm. So what types of athletes in a traditional sport do you think would be good to play netball?
See, that's the greatest thing about netball. And the skill sets that you learn from netball can be translated over to other sports. Say, for example, let's talk about football. You know, a little bit ago we were talking about football and kids playing football continuously. Let's talk about a wide receiver and a quarterback. Teaching a quarterback to quick release within 3 seconds to a wide receiver, there's no defense that's going to be able to read and reset, because in netball you learn to pass in the space. So your athletes already conform and understand that they have to get to that spot because that's where the ball is going to get. So we don't really pass to the player. We pass to the space, mm-hmm. and the player have to get to the space. Yeah. So your body has that muscle memory to do that. So there we talk about football players. And let's talk about basketball. I use netball skill set to play basketball in a league where I was the only female in local league here, 365, and I won the championship. And we use netball principles to do that by passing the ball, not waiting to get down, passing the ball 3-4 passes down, shoot, not waiting to get them down, the next team coming down to set up defense, start pressing, from the beginning because it's easier for us to score. So using those principles, we're able to get basketball players to come over because they have already learned some of the fundamentals. Sports are fundamentals. You learn the basics just like business, and then what you do is you learn the specific skill set to go there. Then we talk about baseball. Baseball being able to know that this is your area that you need to control. So if you're out there, you know, in the left field, because nothing is happening doesn't mean that you don't need to be there. You don't need to be focused. You don't need to pay attention because you'll put your team in a disadvantaged position. So it's advantageous for you to stay there. So these are some of the things. So when you talk about if you have a volleyball player, a tennis player, because like you rightly said, you have speed, agility, endurance, strength, change of direction, understanding speed and velocity, how long you need to let the ball hang in order for it to get to where it needs to be. So any athlete that has a discipline can come over because these skill sets translate.
And you can't jump to shoot, right?
You can do layups. But the things with it is, because one of my sons play, well, both of my sons play, and one of my son, he loved doing layup. But the thing with netball is once you have released your feet from the floor, the ball has to release from your hand. Because if you hit the floor with the ball in your hand and you didn't do a skill set that we call 1-2, which is at the elite player level, then that's a turnover. So the discipline in the sport is amazing. The good thing is, as you're training, and like you guys know with your training and me watching you guys over the year, your body learned muscle memory. So I'll teach one drill in one session, and you learn to play the sport, not even realizing that you learned to do that.
So when I watch, I never see anybody take a shot no less than within 5 feet in. So you can shoot jump shots. So like I can really like shoot like a three-pointer.
You can do, well, if you look up a thing called Netball Fast Five, you'll see where they're doing Fast Five, where they shoot on the outer perimeters, almost like a basketball, with no backboard, and they'll go up and lay it in 3 seconds, and it'll go in clean.
Yeah.
It's just to me, looking at it right now, it make that rim look super small, and it's just, when you look at a goal, you just look at a goal with a backboard. Even though you're not going to hit the backboard to make a shot, but it out to be in there, it'll take some time to get used to just shooting it.
Is the rim the same circumference as the basketball goal? Do you know?
No, it's smaller.
It's smaller.
But let me tell you something that's amazing about what you're saying, that you would think, looking at it, that you can't do it. There's a technique. Like one of the things I tell my kids, you know, I'm like, okay, dip, tip, release, send your wrist with it. Now what you're going to do is going to focus and find the center of the pole. A lot of times when they play basketball, they focus on hitting it in this square in the backboard for it to go in. No. Mm-hmm. Find the center of the pole. You hit it every time.
Mm. The center of the pole? The
center of the pole.
Center.
Okay.
You ready to go try it, Randy?
This might
be the one sport.
No, I was thinking that you can play this because you can't shoot. You're a little bottom heavy. You know what I'm saying? So, like, I think you can play. So, I'll play you one-on-one in this. We don't pass to nobody.
Okay.
All right. Hey, come join us at Bruce Park. Yes,
okay.
Sundays, Saturdays, 4 to 6.
Okay. So you're launching a new campaign called Play Netball. Tell us a little bit about the new campaign and how the nation can support the cause.
Oh, my gosh, you're getting me super excited here. All right, Play Netball Initiative is one where we want everybody to get involved. We're bringing back netball to America because this is where it was founded. So the beauty about netball is that everybody is sitting at this table right now can play the sport. Your children can play. It's co-ed also, so you have all-female team. You have mixed team, which is male and female, and then you have all-male team. So you find that we start with ages 4 and up. So now we can start grooming them from preschool. And just like we were talking about change, using those skill set to translate over to other sports, you can get to do that as well. But what I love about it in the Play Netball Initiative is that it's also teaching the little ones good eyes, hands, and feet coordination.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also giving us an opportunity to bring in that STEM component, which gives them the opportunity to understand how they can apply these skill set to their everyday life and their school. But let's get to the elite level. Right now, we are ranked 32 out of the 48 countries that are ranked. I want to be able to increase that because we increase our ranking and get into the top tier of the top 10.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that we do have the athletes here mm-hmm. in America, considering that we're the country with the most Olympic medals. we do have the athletes here. So that's definitely what I want to do. Get it out there. Get everybody talking about it and everybody playing it. Bringing back that conversation. Put the phones down. Let's interact. And I see where this is happening on the court because I have moms that play. Their kids play. And it's the funniest thing to go on a road trip with them to play to South Florida. Them talking about, Mom, you see I did that on you. You know, I broke your ankles. And it's just fun, and we want to get everybody talking about it.
Is it a net? So you said at the park you were talking about, is it a netball goal permanently there, or you have to bring one there?
Oh, there's a netball court permanently there. Awesome. I had it built a few years ago at Bruce Park. We really were doing well until COVID came in. So my aim is to get some more built out there at Cecil Field. Okay. Yeah.
I think you're right, though. The gene pool that we have here in America is second to none. Actually, when I was on a Zoom call with your guy from Australia, I was mentioning that to him, and he gave me that look like, you bloody American. But we do have the gene pool, and our best athletes play other sports, but if we can get them involved in a sport like that, I think it'd be cool, and I think it'd be an opportunity for all of us to be a part of something big. And one of my long-term goals is to coach an Olympic athlete, so if we can build somebody from scratch here and get them in that position, that'd be huge. So thanks for coming on, though, Radica.
All right, it was my pleasure. Thank you guys for having me.
Good deal.
We enjoyed it.
Well, let's go ahead and do what we do well. Let's pay some bills real quick. This segment was brought to you by First Coast Cargo. First Coast Cargo leads the freight transportation logistics service market and is known as the region's most dependable and highly professional service provider. Contact First Coast Cargo toll-free today at 844-731-2137 for all your professional shipping needs. You're listening to The Amateur's Edge on 1010XL. 92.5 FM.
He doesn't live in the water.
What's going on here?
Get him in the boat.
But he practically lives on it.
Nice. Woo!
Captain Kevin in the Ring Power Fishing Forecast Show. Brought to you by Houston's Meats.
Thursday nights at 6.
On 1010XL AM. Now, a PGA Championship update on 1010XL. Brought to you by Mr. Sparky of the First Coast and MyBookie.
Westwood One Sports presents this special report on the 105th PGA Championship, sponsored by Sleep Number. Sleep next level with a Sleep Number bed, only at a Sleep Number store. The only other time Scottie Scheffler has held at least a piece of the lead after two rounds at a major, he put on the green jacket as Masters champion. Scheffler had the outright lead last year at Augusta. He is in a three-way tie for the lead here. Scheffler, Corey Connors, and Victor Hovland 5-under as the third round is underway with steady rain falling. Connors putting all the skills on display so far this week.
Ball striking is a big strength of mine. I thought that would serve really well, but you know, I knew short game and putting were going to be very important here because, you know, inevitably you're going to find yourself in the rough or, you know, miss some greens and need to be able to scramble.
Yeah, Connors has done that with a plum. Justin Suh and Bryson DeChambeau 3-under, 2 backs up, playing in his first PGA Championship. From Oak Hill Country Club, I'm Ted Emmerich, Westwood One Sports.
For the ones finding new ways to ensure the job always gets done. For the ones wearing many hats. For the ones who are hands-on, even from far away. And the ones keeping business moving forward. We are Grainger, offering professional-grade industrial supplies, plus real-time product availability and access to experts ready to answer your toughest questions. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Wake up, people. You're optimizing every waking hour of your life, from carpooling kids, to work, to friends, and everything in between. You have to get sleep and a bed that can perform as well as you do. Meet the next generation Sleep Number Smart Bed. It effortlessly adjusts to your shape, position, and movements, learning how you sleep, so you learn to sleep better, night after night. Sleep next level, only from Sleep Number. Save 50% on the Sleep Number Limited Edition Smart Bed, plus special financing. Ends Monday. To learn more, go to sleepnumber.com. See store for details.
The best golfing weather is upon us, and Hidden Hills Golf Club invites you to enjoy your round of golf with us. Our warm and welcoming atmosphere and spectacular golf course keeps our customers coming back. Check us out at HiddenHillsGC.com. You'll be glad you did.
Coffee?
Have a cup of coffee with Jacksonville's favorite son, Tony Boselli.
I don't suppose there's any possibility of getting an espresso or a cappuccino.
Breakfast with Boselli.
Brought to you by
Epstein and Robbins DUI Defense Firm. Monday morning on 1010XL.
I'm Justin Norndorf, creator of DVS, a medically backed pitching development program designed to develop young throwers' arms safely. We are excited to be launching our Florida Development Center at B3 Better in Jacksonville. To celebrate DVS, we are offering a free virtual coaches clinic and also giving away 20 free team DVS and athletic assessments at B3 Better. To register for the clinic and your team's chance to win, go to b3better.com/DVS and secure your spot today.
Dave Binion here with Zero Res. I love living in Jacksonville, where we have so many families who serve or have served in the military. I am so grateful for their sacrifice to keep us safe. If you have a family member who is on active duty or is a veteran, now is the time to call Zero Res. Right now, get a 25% military discount on everything we clean. That's 25% off carpet cleaning, tile and grout, upholstery, or oriental rugs. Zero Res, spelled forward or backwards, it's the right way to clean. Zero Res.
Monahan Jewelers is Jacksonville's source for fine jewelry and certified diamonds for 45 years. Have confidence knowing that you're buying the highest quality diamond at the best price. Monahan's has the inventory of several jewelry stores in one location with unbelievable prices. Diamonds, gemstones, and gold jewelry for every budget. At Monahan Jewelers, expect a huge inventory, great prices, expert jewelry repair, and fantastic service. Visit us at monahanjewelry.com or call 246-GOLD for Monahan Jewelers in Atlantic Beach.
Flickering lights and hot switches can be annoying. They can also signal a major problem or electrical emergency. So leave it to the pros and Mr. Sparky.
Call 888-8-SPARKY.
Your on-time electrician, Mr. Sparky of the First Coast.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, the official personal injury law firm of the Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville, the Amateur's Edge. Brought to you by B3 Better. On 1010XL.
And we're back. This has been a great show because we are talking about women in sports and their influence is everywhere. Just, you know, and our next guest, she's a phenomenal woman. She's actually been on the Amateur's Edge before and shared with us some really great information. You know, she's really close to one of the guys on this show. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to let you introduce her.
Okay, this is my sister, Jamesetta Cleveland. She lives in Tennessee. She does so many things. So for me to just point out one thing exactly, it would just belittle her. So she's big into helping youth, especially single moms, in the process of being a student athlete. Jamesetta, are you there?
I am here.
Okay. How you doing, sis? You good?
I'm doing well today. How about yourself?
I am doing great. And you're bringing Sports Family Weekend down to Jacksonville. What is it, June 24th and 25th?
Yes, June 24th and 25th. We are going to be doing the first ever Sports Family Weekend there in Jacksonville, Florida. I'm very excited because I get to partner with you.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be awesome. And the thing about it, like, can you tell, I guess, like, what is it? What it's going to be about? What makes it different from other camps? And what are the goals of the Sports Family Weekend?
I definitely can do that. So the Sports Family Weekend is a weekend retreat for high school football families. So if you're class of 2024 on back to 27, this is for you. And one of the things that I have found in working with sports families is people do things in pockets. They train their kids. They talk about writing essays and getting into college and ACT prep and all of these and recruiting. But all these things, no one ever puts it together so that families understand that there's a journey and there's a method to the madness. So this is a weekend retreat where sports families will learn how college admissions, your athletic talent, and recruiting work together to accomplish your dream.
That is awesome. The thing about it, we got so many good camps coming up next month. You know, my son's having a camp here. Tyreek here is having a camp, and you're having a camp. But I just think your camp is going to really help the young athlete and the parent understand the process. And one question I always wanted to ask you was about your son in the Air Force. What were some of the issues that you had, like, as far as being a mom and him going to a military school?
I would say not even the military piece, but part of the problem is most of the times a parent has never been through the recruiting process before.
So you don't know who to go to. You don't know who to talk to. In Black and brown communities, a lot, and not just ours, but a lot of times athletes are either the first to go to college in their family, or they may be one of the first. So there's like not a lot of knowledge about how does college admissions work? When do you fill the FAFSA? Do you need the SAT? Do you need the ACT? Like, when do you write essays? How do you do all these things? And then NCAA eligibility or NAIA eligibility is a whole different ball of wax. So I didn't know that there was a thing called the 10-by-7 rule. And so I was always looking for where's the place that you go to train parents? Like, who tells us how to put it all together? Everybody wants to train, and there's nothing wrong with that because athletic talent and training is necessary. But there wasn't a place, one, where I could go to get it all in one-stop shop, and two, there wasn't a place that would make me a better parent. And when my son went to college, one of the things that I was doing is, like, I was helping other parents, and I was really focused on, hey, he and your child, you have to raise them to understand that the sport is what they do, not who they are. And when you get into that, very few people talk about athletic identity. So I have a consulting firm because I'm building what I was looking for. It's what I wanted.
And that's huge what you just said about athletic identities. You know, so much goes into these athletes and their quest to play at the highest level. But at some point, they're going to have to stop, right? And when they do stop, they're relatively still young. Even if you're fortunate enough to go play in the NFL 10 years or so, you're still in your early 40s by the time you finish, late 30s, early 40s. And that transition is extremely difficult for those young men and for their families. And the half the population doesn't know the struggle that these guys go through. So having something in place like that, I think, is huge. And I think, by you addressing that, it can change a lot of things.
Yeah, the goal, like one of the things that we want to do in the weekend is just let parents know so many kids are sitting on the couch and they're hugely talented because we entrusted our children's dreams to someone else. We expected the school or the coach, we expected everybody else to know, and we didn't know ourselves. And so it's really important that we as parents at least are equipped. We have knowledge because people say knowledge and power is power, but it's really not. It's applied knowledge. That's what's powerful. And so this is my way of giving back to parents and making sure that we are aware that we have to be an active participant in the pursuit of our child's dreams. And that's more than just dropping them off at practice or at training.
Yeah. I definitely agree with that. So tell us about, because I know you got me helping out, you got Jerrian helping out. Tell us about some people that you got from out of town that's coming to Jacksonville to help out.
So I'm really excited about this because I'm partnering with some people that are near and dear to me. So let me back up and say why I chose Jacksonville, because some people who are listening to this are probably like, she's not even from here. But a large reason why I chose Jacksonville is because I'm close to some people. I've developed some really great friendships with some people who are going to be helping out, like you, Kevin Tolliver, Kevin Van Dyke. We had a YouTube show. We all did. Franklin Robinson. We had a YouTube show called the 10-4 YouTube Show. And I knew that with our knowledge that we could do something really special instead. And so I said, I wanted to go and you pick Jacksonville because my people are there. Mm-hmm. And so partners, obviously my people from 10-4 YouTube Show, but we're also partnering with a nonprofit called Building Lives Through Sports Network. It was founded by Dr. Lalisa Anthony, and most people don't know that she's phenomenal, but she teaches now at the University of Louisville, but she spent 9 years as a consultant for the NFL, helping them develop things like player development, player engagement, and a lot of other things. So I'm partnering with her and her son, Ryan Montgomery, who is a high school football coach in Shelby County, Kentucky. I'm partnering with Carlos Collins, who's a former NFL DB, University of Kentucky graduate, who owns a training
foundation called Perform to Perfection Sports. And I'm partnering with a friend of mine. His name is Terrence Parsons. People may know his son, Micah Parsons. Mm-hmm. And so Terrence owns the Parsons Foundation. And we'll be partnering with another nonprofit called ABC Sports. ABC Sports works with a plethora of current and former athletes from different sports, helping them give back to communities. Corey Harris is a Baltimore Raven, Super Bowl winner. He owns something called, he founded Kick the Stereotypes Foundation. He'll be there. And, of course, B3 Better Sports. But we're really excited. We've built a really solid partnership of people all from all across the country.
That's going to be big. And then, like I said, Jacksonville is the area to do it. I think we're number one in football in the area. We compete with Miami every year. I mean, it's debatable. But, like, I think we're like that. I think we done caught up with them. They might have had the championships from back in the day, but I think, like, our athletes are definitely catching up with them. And we're doing some big things.
And something that's happening in Florida that I think parents are not aware of how it will affect them. I picked Jacksonville because of the relationships I have. But what's going on, not just in Jacksonville, but a lot in Florida, is the educators and support staff are leaving schools. They're going to do other things. Mm-hmm. And what that means is you may have a guidance counselor that's trying to handle, I talked to one, and she was saying her caseload of kids, she's responsible for 300 to 400 kids. Typically, I'm going to be really, really super just blunt. Most of the kids who go on to play college football are Black and brown. Mm-hmm. They come from homes where they have single moms, and they're not always, they don't have the most resources. So parents can't always afford, like, private ACT prep. They can't afford to hire somebody to help them, help the kid write the college admissions essays or go through the process. Some of them, honestly, can't even afford training. And when you think about the fact that we don't have a lot of resources in our community for the extra, and the one resource that we do depend on, the school, is woefully understaffed, it's our kids that come through, that fall through the cracks. And so it's timely because one of the things that they're going to get in the Sports Family Weekend is resources. People who are in places that will help them search for scholarships and will help them fill out FAFSAs, mm-hmm. that will teach them about college admissions. And we need that because we can't always afford, I couldn't afford like a private tutor for all my kids, plus a private trainer, plus ACT prep, that's pricey. And so I didn't know that Jacksonville and Florida in general would be experiencing this when I chose the location, but I'm glad that I did, because if I can help one parent child not fall through their cracks, then that's what it's all about.
I know. I'm still paying Jerrian now for my kids. So, like, I got to pay them about a month.
Good deal.
This is Radica with USA Netball, and I'm listening, and I'm telling you, I am so appreciative of what you're getting ready to do, because I can identify with what you're talking about. I, too, I'm a single mom. I have a 20-year-old and a 21-year-old that, of course, a brown Black boy that goes to a collegiate school that plays football. And one of the things when I started looking at this for them, and this was through COVID, so it made it even worse, I had to teach myself. It's a good thing that I'm a researcher, but I had to go and research how to negotiate, getting them into school. Also emphasizing from early that the sport is not your identity, and that is something that I want to zone in on that you brought up. You know, first we have to let them understand that they're different and recognized outside of the sport, and also really place emphasis on academics, because that was something that I did with my kids. And a lot of time, we also have a youth sports program, and a lot of time as I'm interacting with parents, I realize that that's where they've lost. I didn't know that GPA could fall to 1.25 or below that, mm-hmm. you know, because the standard for my kids is I don't know anything below a 3.0. So I like what you're doing. Hopefully I get a chance to meet you when you come here, because I would definitely love for USA Netball to partner with you in this.
Oh, absolutely. I'm going to have
I'll make sure that we connect. But you are the reason why this is near and dear to my heart. Like, I didn't know what the 10x7 rule was, but I'm a researcher. But if you're a parent and you got to work a job, maybe you're working two jobs, you have multiple kids, sometimes you're running, doing this, doing that, you're just trying to keep them fed. You don't always know that, hey, you have to take a certain number of classes by a certain date, mm-hmm. or your kid is going to not be able to play. Or you don't think that people will keep your child academically eligible to play football in high school, but not prepare them to be admitted to college. We don't often think about what you need to graduate from high school is not the same thing as what you need to be admitted to college. We just say, oh, my kid's talented, somebody's going to find him or her. And that's not how it works. So this is an event where we're bringing resources from all across the country to help parents understand you got to be a student first. This is how college admissions work hand in hand with the recruiting process. This is how scholarship searches, because I'm just going to be real transparent for parents that are listening. Most student athletes do not have a full ride. You need money. And yep. So we're going to bring someone who worked at multiple universities to talk about how do I navigate paying for college, from scholarships to FAFSA to whatever. That's super important because I didn't have time. You know, I had to make the time, but a lot of us, we don't have time to do this over and over and over. So we're bringing it to you in all one weekend. And the goal is that parents really have the...
And that's what's big, because there's no camp in Jacksonville that's ever been around that's going to do that, that's going to educate the parents and educate the kids also. An important thing that people ought to understand, it's not about just the kids that's in high school, it's about the kids that's getting ready to go to high school. So if you know the game plan before you go there, it's definitely going to help you out. Right, Jerrian?
Yeah, that's huge. That's huge. So what are the big takeaways you would say from an athlete and the parent's perspective that they can look for, if you can sum it up in like 30 seconds for me?
Two takeaways for athletes. Clarity. Because a lot of them are saying, every athlete that I know in high school says, what are college coaches looking for? And also, how does my skill set translate to college? So they're going to get that type of clarity. Plus, they're going to get a village. It's my prayer that they'll see a current or former athlete who's been where they're trying to go, that they'll connect to, that they can use as a resource to guide them through the process going forward. Parents are going to get, obviously, information, but also correct expectations. You cannot leave your child's dreams in someone else's hands. Mm. And parents are going to get a village, too. They're going to get a group of people who are professionals in the academic world and also sports parents who've been where they are. And it's my hope that they'll come and be a part of my community once this is over.
And that's a perfect setup. Jamesetta, give us a quick how do our listeners get in contact with you?
They can reach out to me on social media. I am on Facebook at Sports Mom University. That's my Facebook page. Sports Mom University. And they can also find me on Twitter or Instagram at Sports. It's SPORTS_MOM. That's MOM_U, just the letter U. And so would love for people to connect.
Awesome.
Very excited about this event.
Awesome. Thank you so much for being on.
Thank you.
And Radica, same thing for you. How do people get connected to you on U.S. Netball?
Okay, we're on Facebook. It's USA Netball, as well as you can, our website is under construction, but you can also go to fnsasports.com, and you can also send us some information there. We're also on Twitter and Instagram, USA Netball.
Awesome. Listen, this has been a wonderful segment. We've been celebrating women. Listen, make sure that you tune in every week to The Amateur's Edge, because this is what we do, empowering the amateur and their family. So this has been great. You've been listening to The Amateur's Edge on 1010XL, 92.5 FM. We'll see you next week.
Bless.